cartoon. So listen, Cal, so I'm talking to you here. Look at the numbers here. Clearly, DC, if we... We gotta take a look.
I can see the numbers. You don't have to move. Yeah. So maybe DC, the people can't. But right. I can see.
So the people, DC is doing 30% of the comic book sales, while Marvel's doing closer to 40% of comic book sales. You know, clearly something the impetus for DC is not going there anymore. It's not happening. You know?
No. That would be a very faulty way of looking at it.
Okay.
Marvel has 40% of the market share. How many books are they publishing? Now, DC has 30% of the market share. If DC is, and we've already said DC is publishing less books,
yes,
and they have 30% of the market share. Marvel is publishing a lot more books. Okay, a lot more books. DC doesn't do it. I mean, at one point, because DC said, look, they were going to scale back, stop doing as many variant covers. Marvel said, the hell with that. You know, we're going to do a variant cover for everything. You know, literally, you have to see some of these variant covers when these come out. It's a new Ghost Rider book. Okay.
The Black Cat book.
Oh, no, what's recent?
Black Cat.
Silver Surfer Black.
Yeah,
that just came out the other day. Literally, there's at least 5, 6, 7 different covers. And then the expense on them, too, is that, okay, let's somebody decides, well, I want to buy the rarest cover because it's like a throwback Jack Kirby cover or something. Sometimes that book is $400-$500. How much of your market share do you make up by selling just one of those books?
Not much.
No. One of those books, as opposed to somebody else, has to sell 10, 20 books to get close to that.
Okay,
They have to move those numbers. Now, I'm not saying they sell a whole bunch of them, But you do sell them. And who do they sell them to?
Collectors.
The stores. Because the store has to sell that to the collector. In order for these guys to get those books so they can get the markup, they're like, okay, you want this particular variant? You have to order at least 50 copies. You have to order at least 50 copies or 100 copies just to get one of those. So you ordered 100 copies. And how much is each copy of that book? $3? $4? There's your money, and there's where you also move a whole bunch of the numbers too. Okay, when you try to push those variants, it's the same thing. Immortal Hulk was very popular, and they were offering this variant cover, which everybody was speculating on. It was like $150 in the pre-sales. But in order to get it, you had to order a certain number of books. If you didn't order at least say 25 or 50 books, you couldn't get that. You didn't get that cover. You were a store that didn't get that. Now, if you're a smaller store, and you just don't have that type of membership. Maybe 6 people come in and buy Immortal Hulk. You know, are you really going to risk it that month and say, okay,
no,
I'm going to buy 25 of this to get this particular book, and nobody may actually buy it?
But you see, Marvel strategy is a pretty sound strategy where they're flooding the market. Yes, some people dislike it. If the quality is there, it doesn't matter. You know, like some things that they have, like Symbiote Spider-Man has been very popular. People have been buying that. There's just been a lot of talk on that. The Hulk has been very popular. I'm not even going to talk about War of the Realms. But the point is that, you know, they have different price points. So you have the regular price comics. You know, you have some premium comics. But you also have the dollar comics, the true believers that some people are buying just to get introduced to it.
I don't know about that, man.
I see people buying them.
You can get all the stories online for free.
You can get it from online, but you're in the store and you say, hey, let me grab another one.
No.
I think Marvel's just...
I'm in the store like, I'm going to save this dollar and put it towards something that...
But I'm saying the question is probably a casual reader's like, I don't want to commit to $400.
These guys are not buying those books. They're not buying those books because they're like, hey, I wouldn't mind. They're buying those books because a lot of these guys already know the reprints can't appreciate in value. Even a true believer can appreciate in value. It depends on what the print run was, how many are left over, you know, what was the interest. There were certain books like Marvel Milestones, and they reprinted, you know, first issues, first X-Men, you know, first giant size X-Men. Now, some of them, okay, don't retail too well. But others of them, Spider-Man, Captain America, Giant Size X-Men, hey, that was I don't know how much that book was when it came out, but in some instances, it's a $45 book. Same with DC with some of their reprints. Depends on the print run, how rare it is. You know, you can't find it, that type of stuff. Then you can get some money out.
So basically, it's rarity and quality.
Spec book at the end. It's a low cost spec book at the end of the day. Most guys do not want that for their collection.
But that's for collectors. I don't think marketing, they're saying they're putting these books out because of events or...
Yeah, but the events are all tied into... Most of the time when they were putting stuff out, it wasn't tied into... Like, when the movies were getting ready to come out, they reprinted, you know, first appearance of Thanos, first Infinity Gauntlet issue, and then they'll do some other stuff. All the reprints, these are, you know, first appearances,
right.
Okay, first issues, and a lot of these guys collect that. A lot of these guys come over and collect that stuff, but they're not collecting it. Oh, I want to have a complete... No, it's like, hey, this may actually jump off, and it's only $1.
Got it. Okay.
DC's getting ready to do the same thing. They're going to do their own facsimile reprints. And they're going to be, I think the first one is going to be Crisis on Infinite Earths. It's going to be a different cover on it. So they're going to get into that particular game because it doesn't make any sense for them to seed all of that room to Marvel in terms of.
But that's what they've been doing for. That's what they've been basically doing.
Well, they're not doing it anymore. Wow. Because DC was doing the DC was doing the Walmart business, which again was smart for them, and it worked. Marvel was like, no, I'm going to come over here. I'm going to take over with variant covers and dollar books. That's what I'm going to take over with. Okay, and then the stuff in the middle, and nobody's reading that anyway. We don't care.
So interesting. Hey, so continuing with DC News, there was something interesting. If we take a look at, this is from Comic-Con. This is, Comic-Con gets their numbers from Diamond Distributors, the guys who give sell comics to different comic book stores. But as you can see here, the number one comic for the year so far is what? Detective Comics 1000, which was a big thing for DC. And they were selling it at $9.99.
Same thing with Action Comics 1000.
Which is a hell of a price point. I don't know why you bring it. I don't think it sold as much as Detective Comics. But the,
the price was
574,000 that were sold. I mean, that is an incredible amount for a comic.
Action Comics 1000 was the number one selling book of 2018. We'll see how this does when the numbers can finish up.
We'll see how it does. We'll see who wins, who has the most sales.
Yeah, we'll see.
So, continuing. When's the last time?
We'll see.
When's the last time you had a comic book? And I think it was in comicbook.com. You know how hard it is to get $1 million comic selling. You know, it doesn't look as though we're going to have another one coming back. The market just doesn't seem to be able to.
Well, to be honest, the price point on this is what keeps this from being $1 million seller. If this price was cheaper, maybe half of that, you might have actually sold, you know, 1 million copies. You can get a million copy selling comic book. It's not impossible. You would have to attach it to an event. It does have to be with a popular character. It has to be affordable. You can definitely get that. You could definitely get something.
But it hasn't
like that
been done in any time, well, recent time.
Look, the last time you
is Star Wars.
Yeah, but again, it was Star Wars.
That's true.
I mean, even if you look at the top one selling at all time, these were Death of Superman, which was attached to that big event, and then the X-Men number one. But I mean, another reason why that sold as many copies as it did is that they had like five different covers. And if you were a completist, and I mean, especially at that time, you're like, I got to get all the covers. You got to have that full set, you know, make certain I'm complete, because you don't know which one is going to be the one to jump off. And, you know, of those covers, you know which one is the primary one, the one that really, you know, packs the most money?
What?
None of them. It's the reprint. There's a reprinted cover that's rarer than any of those issues, and that's the one that sells for the most money. I know because I have it. So
that's pretty interesting. So, I mean, I guess it's quality and quantity and rarity, right?
It's rarity and scarcity at the end of the day. I mean, you could have a book like, I would say, like Amazing Fantasy 15. Okay, that's a rare book. You don't see that but it's not scarce. Okay, mm-hmm. It pops up. Not everybody has it, but it pops up with regularity. So it's a rare book to get, and not everybody has it, but it's not hard to, it's not really hard to find. Then you have rare and scarce, like the EC comic books. Okay, so, you know, along those times, okay, this is a rare book, and you just don't see it every day. You know, when it pops up, it pops up.
Oh, that's so cool. That's interesting thought. Didn't think of it like that at all. Not at all. I mean...